In the 13th year of the reign of Josiah, the son of Ammon, king of Judah, the word of the Eternal came to a young lad from the town of Anathoth in the land of Benjamin. Anathoth was a village of the Levites. In this town of impressive men lived a teenaged boy, Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah. God said unto Jeremiah, "Before I formed you in the belly, I knew you. And before you came forth out of the womb, I sanctified you, and I ordained you a prophet unto the nations." The young Jeremiah was overwhelmed at this calling. He tried to explain to God how his youth made him unqualified for such responsibilities.
"I'm just a child, I'm just a boy. I don't know how to speak or how to stand strong. Who would believe the words I say? I'm just a child, I'm just a boy today." As an ordinary lad in a town of pious men, if I looked for one bright star, chances are I would find 10. In their halls they weigh the world, judging matters so profound. Yet consumed in youthful play, on the streets I would be found. I'm just a child, I'm just a boy. So few things these lips have said, even less these eyes have seen. See these rosy cheeks unscarred, see these hands still soft and clean. What king would hear the speech uttered from this boyish frame? Such consequential words need a man of great acclaim. I'm just a child, I'm just a boy. A prophet from the womb, who has heard of such a thing? They would laugh it all to scorn, all the tidings that I bring. And if this message were received as if from a prominent man, they would silence me in haste, they would bind me with their bands. I'm just a child, I'm just a boy. I don't know how to speak or how to stand strong. Who would believe the words I say? I'm just a child, I'm just a boy today."
Despite Jeremiah's best attempts to get out of this unprecedented calling, the Eternal God would not accept any excuses. He lovingly exhorted and encouraged the young man for the missions that lay ahead. Unto Jeremiah, this is what the Word of God said.
Speak all I command.
after Jeremiah's calling, God sent Jeremiah to Judah's capital, Jerusalem. The college there, home to Huldah, the famous prophetess of the day, would be a good training ground for the young prophet. As Jeremiah came to terms with his God-given commission, his love for King David grew. Jeremiah studied David's poetry, the way he thought, the way he loved God. He studied the culture David had created, the music and dance he had established in preparation for the temple's construction. In all these things, Jeremiah sought to emulate his beloved and respected predecessor's ways, and he brought it with him wherever he went. The prophetess Huldah was the one who had told King Josiah that God would delay Judah's punishment until after his reign, since he had zealously cleansed the land of idolatry. However, Josiah's untimely death in battle meant the inevitable was coming sooner than anyone had expected. Judah had passed a point of no return. Jeremiah's warning to Judah began at the temple, a message that would soon have him banned from the temple grounds. Yet Jeremiah knew the message still had to be delivered there. So he dictated a scroll to his servant Baruch, son of Neriah. Baruch still had free access to the temple. So Baruch read the words of Jeremiah in the house of the Eternal at the entry of the new gate in the ears of all the people. From his scroll, he warned of the inevitable calamity to fall on Judah.
Josiah was king of our nation. when God told him how it would fall. His death set God's plan into motion to put us in Babylon's thrall. God gave us a plentiful country. God gave all the blessings we wanted. We turned from his way and went backward to his face with our idols we taunted. Are we not concerned when we pass the point of
The scroll's message made such an impact that it soon found its way into the court of the king himself. King Jehoiakim was infuriated by its contents. He destroyed it and commanded that Jeremiah and Baruch be found and executed. But his searches turned up fruitless. It was not long until Josiah's widows, Queen Mother Zebudah and I, Hamutal, heard of all that had transpired. Learn well, my beloved granddaughters, this important lesson about the power of God's word.
Listen, my daughters, and heed. The prophet was barred from the temple. Priests would not hear what he said. They kept him outside, secure in their pride. But his scribe preached the message instead. The man took his scroll to the king. They came with God's message to punish. He cut it in half and burned it to ash, but soon it came back even stronger. This is God's unstoppable word, his unbreakable vow. His invincible plan will not be foiled by a man. This is God's unstoppable word. His unclosable door, his unquenchable flame. Who can stand in the way of his unstoppable word? The king made a fatal decree. He called for the death of God's man, but he sought him in vain. Throughout his domain, he could not impede God's great plan. This is God's unstoppable word. Oh, listen, my daughters, and hear how God is Lord.
Now it had come to pass that in the third year of Jehoiakim's reign, that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had come unto Jerusalem and besieged it. After 8 years of serving Nebuchadnezzar, the arrogant Jehoiakim stopped paying tribute to the Babylonians. So Babylon invaded Jerusalem, arrested the king, and threw him off the city walls to his death. Jehoiakim's 18-year-old son, Jeconiah, took over Judah's throne. Thank you. Yet Jeconiah did evil in the sight of the Eternal. Neither did he yield to Nebuchadnezzar's rule. Into his reign, Jeconiah was carted off to Babylon as a slave. The Babylonians, eager to have a submissive monarch on Jerusalem's throne, installed Jeconiah's uncle, Jehoiakim's brother, Mattaniah. His name was changed to Zedekiah. Once King Zedekiah was installed on Judah's throne, the Babylonians departed, secure in the thought that this puppet king would keep Judah under their control. In the Babylonians' absence, ambassadors and princes came to Judah from other nations, advising Zedekiah to take a stand with them against Nebuchadnezzar. Zedekiah sought counsel from prophets to see if this alliance was a wise move. These were not men whom God had sent, and they foolishly advised Zedekiah to join the resistance. This contradicted everything Jeremiah had been preaching in the city streets, where he wore a yoke to depict the oppression Babylon would continue to put on Judah. One of these prophets, Hananiah, made a public appearance speaking against Jeremiah, saying that in 2 years God would break Babylon's yoke.
Ambassadors came to plead with the king. Throw off the chains that Babylon brings. God heard of their plan, he warned them through me. I made 5 yokes to send to their kings. I wore one myself to show to the land that Babylon rules by God's mighty hand. Oh, to
I tell.
explain what he should well know. He says you are free, but you are in bonds. In time you will see which prophet is wrong. You are the one who speaks of a lie. By God's great decree, this year you will die. Oh, Judah, heed. God speaks through Judah. Believe. God speaks through me. How I will rejoice. Already trapped, their yoke is of iron. You speak of a lie. By God's great decree, this year you will die. Oh, Judah, believe. God speaks through me.
God speaks through me.
God
Just as Jeremiah prophesied, within the year, Hananiah died. And when Nebuchadnezzar heard of the alliance Zedekiah was forming against him, his armies marched into Jerusalem and besieged the city yet again. Babylon's siege cut off all supplies and resources to the nation's capital. This caused the people to cry out to God for deliverance.
Make haste to hear.
God heard the cry of Jerusalem's inhabitants. He saw their repentant attitude, and suddenly Babylon abandoned its siege. Yet the people had not turned completely to God. Soon after Babylon left, the people reverted to their own wicked ways. Meanwhile, Babylon launched a campaign against Egypt and successfully conquered this kingdom to Judah's south.
Thank you.
Josiah's message soon met resistance from the civil government. The authorities arrested him and threw him into prison. While incarcerated, Jeremiah was commanded by God to purchase a plot of land in Anathoth to show the Jews that there was hope for their return after captivity. Yet Judah's princes assumed that Jeremiah's purchase meant he was in league with the Babylonians, that once Babylon took Judah captive, Jeremiah would be assured a life of ease back in his hometown. Surely, they reasoned, Jeremiah had to make some sort of deal with Babylon and offer them information that would have compromised Judah's defenses. Four of these princes went straight to the king and petitioned for Jeremiah's swift execution.
Jeremiah is a traitor,
selling us to Babylon.
He has crept outside the city.
To their army he has gone.
He has given up the city, so he lives when they have won. Let him die, let him die. He would have the city fall. Let him pay with his life. He would make slaves of us all.
Jeremiah is a traitor,
speaking lies of Babylon.
He has kept our fighters frightened
till their strength is nearly gone.
He has frightened all the city, so their army will have won.
So their army will have won.
Let him die.
Let him die.
Let him die.
Let him die.
He would have the city fall.
Let him die.
Let him pay.
Let him die.
With his life.
Let him die.
He would make slaves of us all.
Zedekiah discouraged an actual execution for Jeremiah, so the princes cast him into a dungeon prison where there was a cesspool of mire so deep that they were sure Jeremiah would die if incarcerated there. Yet one of the king's righteous and loyal eunuchs, an Ethiopian by the name of Abedmelech, caught wind of this evil plot. He ran to the king, explaining what the princes had done and how Jeremiah's death would incite God's anger even further.
My Lord, hear me, I beg. The man of God will die. The princes laid him low. None can hear his cry. You gave him to their hands. They dropped him in the mire. I plead you stop this now and frustrate their desire. Let your humble servants go to save the man of God. I bid you let me go to save him from this fate. If you should let him die,
Not my intent. No man should perish so. I give you my assent. You, my loyal servant, go save the man of God.
I'll save the man of God.
Save the man of God.
I'll save the man of God.
So Abed-Melech the Ethiopian rescued Jeremiah from the dungeon's cesspool. Jeremiah told the eunuch how he would be protected from the coming siege because of his faithful service to God's prophet. Jeremiah remained imprisoned until the Babylonians returned and continued their siege of the city. In this third wave of Babylon's conquest, they would burn the city, destroy the temple, and take many of the leading citizens captive to Babylon. After Judah's defeat, one of its captains released Jeremiah from prison. Jeremiah learned the fate of Judah's king and its royal line, how Nebuchadnezzar had slain Zedekiah's sons, put out Zedekiah's eyes, bound him with chains, and carried him captive to Babylon. Jeremiah believed in God's promise that David's dynasty would never cease. Yet he found himself confused and discouraged by the execution of the king's sons.
My Lord, hear me, I beg. Your covenant you made void, you cast it to the ground. Your king have you cut off. You have profaned the crown. You made his glory cease. You covered him with shame. How shall your promise fail? Has David vain? How can any servant now save the throne of God?
Yes, David, seed lives on through all apparent plagues, and though his tree looks burned,
Jeremiah was now in Mizpah, a city populated by those whom Nebuchadnezzar had left in Judah. There, he discovered survivors of the royal family, the king's daughters. David's dynasty would carry on through a princess named Tephi, who was now married to the prince of Dan. Soon, the refugees of Mizpah felt unsafe there. Johanan, the governor of Mizpah and caretaker of its refugees, sought to take everyone to Egypt. He asked Jeremiah to inquire of God if this would be wise. And God answered and said unto the people,
I hear your prayer, this is my word. If you will stay, then I will build. I will then plant and cause you to grow. This land that I grant is for you to sow.
Yet Mizpah's leaders had already decided to take the settlers to Egypt, including Jeremiah and the king's daughters. On the way, Jeremiah prophesied of Nebuchadnezzar's impending invasion. Faithless Jews scoffed, but God's word came to pass. All those who went to Egypt were killed or taken back to Babylon. Only those who believed Jeremiah escaped back to Judah, including Princess Tephi and her husband. From there, Jeremiah, Baruch, Tephi, and others in the royal entourage would head to the prince's homeland.
God is the Lord of all. His promise prevails, His word never fails. Those who trust Him never fall. God said of my father, King David, his kingdom would never end. His scepter and line would last for all time, though others might try to contend. This is God's unstoppable word, his unbreakable vow. Invincible plan will not be foiled by a man. God's unstoppable word, his unclosable door, his unquenchable flame. Who can stand in the way of his unstoppable word? My brothers and father are taken. Not be foiled by a man. God's unstoppable word, his unclosable door, his unquenchable flame. Who can stand in the way of
God's unstoppable word, his unbreakable vow, his invincible plan? Will not be foiled by a man. This is God's unstoppable word.
Thank you. The morning radiance melts the mists away, unveiling views that I have long desired. A sight that shows the end of stormy paths, a destiny that kept my heart inspired. My life can be compared to this journey on the sea, with winds and waves and waters rising high. What kept me pressing on, what kept my course unchanged, is what now lies just north before my eyes. It was the vision on the horizon that burned within my bones when facing the unknowns. There was the vision on the horizon that kept me looking through the storm, transfixed by the approaching shore. I faced the foaming waves of certain death, and once was doomed to drown in dungeon mire. The persecution fell like violent hail, until my battered soul began to tire. The scoffing that I faced was more than I could bear, so silence was the only cure I found. But holding in words oppressed me even more. This fire within my bones could not be bound. It was the vision on the horizon that burned within my bones when facing the unknowns. There was the vision storm, transfixed by the approaching shore. Was it some quest for worldly gain, or a search for passing fame? Was it just some daring game, facing the unknowns? There was the vision on the horizon that kept me looking through the storm, transfixed by the approaching shore.
The annals of Irish history say that an elderly, white-haired patriarch came to Ireland in 569 BC, bringing the princess Tia Teffy and her husband, the Prince of Ireland. Jeremiah also brought a harp, the Ark of the Covenant, and a mysterious stone called Liathfail, or the Stone of Destiny. In Ireland, Jeremiah established a system of law and government headquartered on a hill that he named after the Law of God. The Hebrew word for law is Torah. Thus, this region was named Tara Hill. It was here, on Tara Hill, that the fire in Jeremiah's bones only continued to grow. He established colleges as his forefather Samuel the prophet had done. He raised the ruins of his beloved predecessor, King David, emulating and promoting the fine music, instruments, poetry, and dance that David had established for temple worship long ago. Jeremiah turned Ireland into a prolific and renowned center of high culture. Most importantly, his commission to keep the throne of David alive had now been
welcome the royal sun, welcome the coming tide.
Welcome the banner of courage,
welcome his beautiful bride.
Welcome the future stars,
welcome the glorious dawn.
Welcome the seat of mercy,
welcome the end.
Promises sealed.
See how the